Penguin Random House Audio presents Morgenthau, Power, Privilege, and the Rise of an American Dynasty by Andrew Meier, read for you by Mark Deakins. This program includes a downloadable PDF that contains images from the book. I had to wait until I was 55 to enter public service, but you don't have to, and you shouldn't. It's a privilege. Henry Morgenthau Sr. to his grandson Robert M. Morgenthau. Prologue. 1 Hogan Place. I never look back. In a career unlike any other in the annals of American law, he prosecuted every order of crime and every species of criminal. Bribe takers and bribe givers, serial killers and drug dealers, mobbed up families and mobbed up industries, molesters and rapists, stalkers and terrorists, gun runners and gamblers, prostitutes and vigilantes, loan sharks and digital pirates, bookmakers and boiler room operators, arms dealers and inside traders. He had seen the good go bad. Crooked politicians, crooked cops, crooked bakers, crooked truckers, crooked union bosses, crooked bankers, crooked accountants, crooked ambassadors, crooked priests, crooked rabbis, crooked doctors, crooked coroners, crooked engineers, crooked PTA officers, crooked CIA agents, crooked philanthropists, crooked turnpike authority executives, crooked traders, crooked defense attorneys, crooked prosecutors, crooked judges, and crooked inspectors of everything made in New York City, from its stakes to its skyscrapers to the cement of Yankee Stadium. There were crimes of passion, too, but few by comparison. The urge always seemed to start and end with money. Money was oxygen. Stop the flow, he would say, and you'll stop the crime. Now, after 35 years as the district attorney of New York County, Robert Morris Morgenthau, at 90 years old, was leaving the job. A quartet of reporters flanked the DA, one on either side, two across the long table. The last of the farewell press conferences had come weeks earlier. Now, as he spoke, photographers ducked in and out, edging the half-packed boxes that formed islands in the cavernous room to record the final hours. It was nearly 8 o'clock on a cold Friday evening, New Year's Eve, in the last year of the first decade of the new century, and the district attorney, called the boss by three generations of prosecutors, was holding court one last time. Since 1937, when Thomas Dewey became district attorney, only three men in New York had won election to the office. Frank Hogan, the dapper Irishman who succeeded Dewey, served 32 years. Morgenthau assumed the post in 1975 and stayed in it until 2009. Previously, he had served 9 years as the chief federal prosecutor in New York, the United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York, from 1961, when John F. Kennedy appointed him, until 1970, when Richard Nixon could suffer him no more. In all, he had been a fixture in the firmament of law and order for 6 decades, and not only in New York City. Bob Morgenthau, as only the few he let in close could call him, had no cause to rush his last press conference. Little had he loved more all these years than to hold a conclave in his thrall, and he knew he would miss it. 2 inches shy of his former 6 feet, as lean as he was at 21, 156 1/4 pounds then, 157 now, he retained a lanky agility. His gait had slowed to a shuffle, and he had long since given up cigars. Bordeaux remained his lone indulgence, but for years he had practiced Tai Chi and yoga, switching between the two on alternate mornings. The face was distinctive, long, and angular. He was fine-boned and clean-shaven, his hair a cottony white. His forehead was broad and high, but it was the nose, bent like a hawk's and angled right, that was most prominent. His blue-gray eyes hinted at unseen strength. He seemed to use them as props now, squinting to forecast disbelief and shuttering them with one hand as if to conjure thought. They could be watery, but the eyes were keen, and when opened wide, they revealed a startling depth. "What will you do?" a reporter asked. No plans to quit working, he said. In the winter of 2009, Morgenthau was not only the retiring district attorney, he was a city institution. At one of the many dinners honoring him that year, he was introduced as the DA for life and maybe after. No prosecutor in U.S. history had served longer, and none had had a more profound influence on law enforcement. None of the contenders, Dewey, Hogan, Rudy Giuliani, came close. Even the new man in the White House hailed the legacy. Introducing his first nominee to the Supreme Court, Sonia Sotomayor, one of the DA's celebrated protégés, Barack Obama affixed the adjective legendary to the Morgenthau name. Morgenthau had long since outlived ambition or ideology. In his final months in office, asked to explain his endurance, he gave the credit to luck and longevity. You've got to have Lady Luck sitting on your shoulder, he would say. The line, a souvenir of the war when he faced German bombers in the Mediterranean and Japanese kamikazes in the Pacific, had proven its worth. On the banquet circuit, it cut short the questioning, but to his wife, children, and closest friends, the words rang untrue. He was a man, they knew, who drew his resolve and stamina from another source. Robert Morgenthau was a scion of one of the great American families. His great-grandparents, Lazarus and Babette Morgenthau, arrived in New York from Germany in 1866, the year after Appomattox. Once wealthy, Lazarus had lost everything. He would live to see his children grow rich again. In America, the Morgenthaus fulfilled a dream, becoming 100% American. They had helped elect presidents, expose a genocide, and wage war. They had formed a dynasty. Henry Morgenthau, Robert's grandfather, born in the Grand Duchy of Baden in 1856, was among the first in the Democratic Party to back Woodrow Wilson for president. Henry Jr., Robert's father, born on the Upper West Side of Manhattan in 1891, was Franklin D. Roosevelt's longest-serving aide, a confidant of three decades, one of the first to see FDR unable to walk, and among the last to see him alive. And the DA, who raced sailboats with the Kennedys as a boy on Cape Cod, was at Bobby Kennedy's side on November 22, 1963. The Morgenthaus belonged to that tribe of would-be patricians, the German Jews. Our crowd. The words could make the DA wince, but his Aunt Hattie, a Lehman, coined the phrase, and his family was one of the aristocracy's exemplars. New Yorkers who for centuries somehow managed to rise above every barrier, neither German nor Jew. Robert Morgenthau was a lifelong member of our crowd and, since his first term as DA, a trustee of Temple Emmanuel, the granite cathedral on Fifth Avenue built to rival St. Patrick's 14 blocks to the south. His blood, as his future wife would reassure her Protestant grandmother, ran as blue as yours. The Morgenthaus were called the Jewish Kennedys and remained, as the former mayor Ed Koch remarked, the closest we've got to royalty in New York City. The DA relished the lineage. At six, he met Calvin Coolidge in the White House and had met every president since. The family history also traced many of the century's decisive turns, the sea swell of immigration to America, the Armenian Genocide, the New Deal, the Holocaust, and the rise and fall of organized crime in New York City. Even before the advent of World War, the rise of dictators in Europe, and the appearance of the word genocide, Morgenthaus had lent their power and privilege to lonely causes. They did not always succeed, but whether out of a foolhardy belief in their own authority or merely to avoid the guilt of inaction, they seldom recoiled from a fight. Even more rarely did they give ground. As a boy, Robert Morgenthau rode in his grandfather's Lincoln limousine, the old man pointing out the buildings along Broadway he had bought and sold. By 1920, Henry Morgenthau could claim world renown. Armenians revered his name. He had exposed their massacre at the hands of the Turks. At home, the power brokers of the Democratic Party, which he joked he had once bought for $30,000, called him Uncle Henry, their faithful financier. But he had risen as a real estate man. Others in New York, Astor's, Vanderbilt's, and Whitney's, gained greater fame, but Henry Morgenthau was one of the first to build a corporate trust.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.